Welcome to the Horn Talk at the Fireplace. Today we have a guest from Switzerland, Professor Bruno Schneider. Bruno, welcome here in Middelzell. Please tell us a short biography of yours.
Thank you very much for the invitation. Very happy to be here at this little chat with you. I grew up in Switzerland, in the French part of Switzerland, in a town called La Chaux-de-Fonds, in the Jura. It's a town about 1,000 meters high and quite famous for the watches, especially. And yes, and in La Chaux-de-Fonds was also a very nice conservatory. With a very interesting personality as a director of the school, who was not only director of the school, but also a horn player and a violin player, who had been solo horn in Lausanne, Geneve Orchestra. And when I was 9 years old, the age where you start to look for an instrument in the good families, I chose the horn for different reasons. First of all, I knew, because I had become a little trumpet without valves, a clairon, when I was 7, and I knew I could play some notes on it. And then also I liked the shape of the instrument, the little bit mysterious aspect of the horn, that you hear the sound from behind, you look at the player, and the sound doesn't go directly to you, to the public in the hall. And also I had heard a concert with Baumann, who came to La Chaux-de-Fonds and played Mozart III with the Stuttgart Chamber Orchestra. And so I chose this instrument. I think I was at this time the only student of my teacher, which was also something I kind of liked. And I started to play an instrument that my father bought for me, a horn from Lidl, from Brno, Czech horn. And then I had to sign a paper from my father, who did a kind of a contract with me. I said, I will pay you the lessons, I will pay you an instrument, but you have to promise that you will practice regularly and that you won't throw away your instrument after a few months.
Was he an administration man or a teacher? Or a
no, he was a surgeon. He was a surgeon, which is also almost an artistic profession, actually. Mm-hmm.
It has to be very exact.
Yes.
Yeah. Everything. Mm-hmm. And then a professional career? How did it go on?
And then, so I started with 9, and then pretty fast my teacher noticed that I had the abilities for the horn. I played with 12, I played the first time with orchestra, Mozart III, and then when I was 15, my teacher brought me to the Lausanne Chamber Orchestra to audition to Armin Jordan, the conductor. And he listened to me and he thought that I would be able to come and play sometime with the orchestra in Lausanne. So I was admitted pretty young in the professional world. And so I played with 17 in the Orchestra Suisse Romande, the whole Wagner ring, and with Peter Marr, who was conducting, I remember this. And so very easily, actually, I just slipped into the professional world. And after I finished my studies in La Chaux-de-Fonds, in my hometown, with 20, kind of a bachelor, I went to Germany, to Detmold, to study 2 years with Michael Herzl, and to have the diploma and concert examination, yes, concert exam, soloist diploma. And right after my study, I got a position in Zurich in the Tonhalle as a solo horn, when I was 22. And after 2 years, I thought maybe it would be good to travel a little bit. So I auditioned in Munich in the Bayerischer Rundfunk Orchestra. And now I can say it was my destiny to come to Munich and to try your instruments and to meet you at the same time. So somehow
it was a good... do you remember when it was?
It was a good decision. Yes, I remember the first meeting. I cannot really say exactly, but I remember very well when I tried an instrument that you had made, and you have give it to Johannes Ryskowski. And this instrument, we tried this instrument during the rehearsals with the orchestra. And in this time, I was a little bit between different instruments. I was between a double horn and between a B high F horn. I was looking. I realized that my way of playing was maybe needed something more than just a double horn. One of my big, one of my favorite horn players at this time was Hermann Baumann, who had this very expressive way to play. And Hermann, of course, was playing very well on the discant horn. He was somebody who could really sing out on the instrument. And this was actually more the direction that I wished to have. So I tried the horn that you just had made, which was a triple horn with high F, compensated triple horn with high F. And I think after 3 minutes, I liked it so much that I kept it. And that's how we came in contact. And since this time, I played only Schmidt horns. So I was a very faithful person. Yes.
Yes. Did it help your development? Did you find what you...
Yes, I think definitely it gave me the security that I was looking, and also to play a triple horn especially gave me the freedom to play every repertoire. So these are instruments you can play concerto, you can play in the orchestra, because from the sound and from the technical side, this is a perfect instrument that you don't have to really get totally prepared to play this or this or this. But you can pick up the instrument and play. And I had also a lot of fun to search for different finger combination. And then when I got the triple horn with high E flat, it was quite much later actually, about 15 years ago, then I was also fascinated to learn something new, to take an instrument and to have new combination and relearn practically the repertoire. I had to relearn all Mozart concerto, Strauss, etc., with new fingering and new ideas. And so I was never bored, and I had a lot of fun to learn this.
I think I remember you recorded the Mozart concertos on this very first horn.
Yes.
Then later you love the E-flat combination, provides quite different possibilities, of course. Yeah. What is the sense for horn playing, for making music for you?
Well, for me personally, of course, the sense of making music is, it's not even really a sense, but it was a need to become a musician. I could not really imagine myself in another profession, really. I think that for me to express myself with the music was something I had to do. But of course, the sense of being a musician can be very different. And there's probably at the end, it's a combination of everything. It's a way to make money, to make your living, of course. It's a social, very interesting and changing life. You know, you meet a lot of people, you play with different people, you share very intense moments with different people on stage. Then you have the contact with the public, which you don't have in many professions, actually, a contact like this. And also, now, since many years that I'm teaching, I feel very lucky to have this contact with the young people all the time, and to be able to share, and also to give, but also to learn a lot from teaching, from which keeps you obliged to stay away. Yeah. And,
What do you think about the present trend all over the world to play the same style and to follow just very few idols, and that some styles in playing are dying out?
Yes, it's too bad that this is, of course, the globalization, so that the heroes are not national heroes anymore, but they are global heroes. So the students have influences not only from their teachers in their country, but they are influenced by the way that big stars are playing. And they have possibilities to hear these people on YouTube and so on. So the models have been universal now. And this is, I think, one of the reasons that the style is becoming unique somehow. But I think it's very sad, and I push my students to go in their own direction and to search their own expression, and not to try to imitate or to come into one model, because they think this is the only way to become a musician is to play like this, or to play this instrument, you know. And this is very, very sad. I mean, this is something also quite typical by the wind players, especially. By the strings players, you have more different directions. Yes.
Bruno, what do you think? Should a horn group play the same model of instrument?
I have never been in a horn section where everybody was playing the same instrument. And so for me, actually, I never came to this idea, even when I was playing first horn. I never thought of obliging my colleagues to play the same instrument. I think it doesn't really matter. The personality, the way you blow, the way you make music is much, much more important than the instrument that you play. The instrument should be an instrument that's so good that you don't have to fight against it, that helps you to play well. If you have a good speaking, and if the instrument is able to respond for a piano or a forte with the same quality of sound, this is the most important thing. But to have everybody playing the same instrument, for me, can be even counterproductive, because then maybe you have somebody that played a long time, a long period in his life, one instrument, and suddenly he has to play another one. Maybe he doesn't feel comfortable, and maybe he will never feel comfortable. And I have even examples of players that came into big difficulties. They changed instrument, they came into big difficulties until they realized actually they had to go back to their old instruments. And then suddenly they felt hope. They had the feeling, now I feel comfortable. Because the difference between instruments is not only the way it's built and the sound and everything, but it's also a whole ergonomic feeling. And sometimes you can take an instrument and then you will put the embouchure, the pressure, a little different way, and it can kill your way, your comfort.
Yes. The airflow, yeah, you must feel how the instrument is, what the instrument allows, and then you have to get used to the instrument. And of course, some cannot get along with a certain type of instrument.
Exactly. And I think to decide if an instrument fits to you or not is something that is very fast. The first note that you play, and when you take even the instrument in the hand, you feel right away, and for me it's like this, if you are comfortable with it or not.
Yes. It's the acoustical inside. If this is really correct, very exact, then you feel well on the instrument. Back to the styles, I think mainly the styles with vibrato died almost out, like French style, the style of playing in Russia, and vibrato, why not? It's a very good possibility to express yourself, to tell emotions.
Absolutely, absolutely. But and the vibrato exists on every wind instrument, even on the brass. The trumpet players, most of the big soloists on the trumpet play with vibrato. The trumpet without vibrato is quite boring, actually. It's not really expressive. And if I think of
violin also,
and the violin also, the flute, if you think of the
voice
without vibrato, the voice, etc. So all this, oboe, etc. So, but of course, as I said before, now the young people all over the world, they are influenced by big names that they hear all the time, and that are a kind of example, and those people, most of them don't play with vibrato. And vibrato is not something that you can learn, like you can learn to make lip trills, or you can to play chromatic, or you can learn to have a nice tonguing, etc. But to learn vibrato is something, it's more letting go feeling, that consciously way to make a vibrato with physical abilities. It's more a way to say, okay, I will give to my sound some liberty. So this is how I think about the vibrato. I never do consciously vibrato. I say, oh, this note I have to do now.
No, vibrato does not mean at all that it's out of tune. These kind of vibratos existed. But of course, progress in intonation, in rhythm, in technique, in perfection, security, everything very good and necessary. But this progress would be possible in just every style which existed in horn playing. And it's a pity that this.
It's a pity. There is one.
Copied one style.
There is one part of instrument that still do a lot of vibrato is the hunting horn. The French hunting horn. And they do sometimes so much vibrato that they switch to the other natural notes.
Yes.
You know?
You can shoot a football.
Yes, and it's
through
when
the
you ball. Hear these hunting horns, I mean, for me, it takes me really
yes,
in the stomach.
It's
so, you know, it's really it takes you to the heart because
yes.
There is something coming from the inner, you know. Without vibrato, totally straight, is nearer to a machine than to to a human.
Exactly. And it would be possible to take over something of this expression of the trompe de chasse. And I heard it formerly with French players. Sometimes, of course, the vibrato was so big that it was not really absolutely in tune. And some conductors had problems with this. But it's a pity that I did not develop this forward and perfectionize this.
But you see, the French school was related to big names, Devet, Barbotte, etc. And now, of course, the models are maybe not so present internationally. And also, there is no more instrument maker in France.
Yes, there was this ascending system. Do you know this ascending
system? Yes, of course, yes, very well. And I think it was a brilliant idea, and this system, now you brought it back actually through the high E flat horn, where you have a beautiful C horn with 1 and 2 on the third bar, and then this is a very helpful tonality in many, many situations. If I think of Beethoven 6, for example, or Schubert, etc., well, many situations.
Indeed, I wanted to help that this French style would survive, and offered an ascending double horn. And some played it. And at the same time, of course, I offered the combination, the between B flat and E flat. And if you press the third valve on E flat, you have the same like on an ascending horn, the sounding concert C horn. And without wanting this, I hope that this kind of instrument died out. But this has nothing to do with the style of playing. To play this, I would say, developed style of French style of playing would have is possible on any instrument. It does not depend on an ascending system. I like an identification, yes, but
yes,
it would be possible to play this on a normal double horn of these days or double horn.
But this identification, I think that's one of the things that makes the schools. You know, if you have a French, if you had a French instrument built in France, and Casalet and the big French soloists would play this French instrument, I think it would be for the French school of horn playing, it would be a motivation more. Like in Germany now, many people are playing instrument that we are not going to name here, you know, but it's also, for many people, this is related to the German school, you know, and so it's not, and of course, these players are also helping this company and so on. I mean, this is something that's very much related.
Yes.
And you have, of course, another clientele, I would say. You have the chance to have touch with your instrument people all around the world. And the reasons why they choose to play Schmid horn is just because the instruments are really, obviously and objectively, somehow better.
And I want to offer different models, bell measures, which fit to every style. There's the compact, the more concentrated sound, the golden cut, just in the middle, with all possibilities to express yourself, to play all kinds of sound, and the wide one for a low horn player, and also now Hollywood sound. That's new. I think it's also a pity that the style of Hollywood film studios is not played anymore. Maybe in the studio sometimes, but it's also an interesting style. So I want to help that the horn world, horn playing is more interesting, that different styles are possible to play on my instruments. And if you hear that students think they have to play this or that model to have a chance, it's a pity. They should not look on the instrument, but they should listen how it sounds. Whether a student is a musician or not, and can play well. So, we make a toast on tolerance and on making music.
Thank you very much. Cheers.